How deep to find this love for us? How vast beyond all measures that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasures? How great the pain of sin loss to find the turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Ashamed to hear my mocking voice called out among those scoffers. It was my sins that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds has paid my ransom.
The rest lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to see, and grace my fears relieved. Grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like the flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
Hi, good morning. Happy Sabbath, everybody. Wherever you're joining us from this morning, we're honored that you've decided to make Hillaby your home this morning. As we begin, we want to start off with a word of prayer. Please bow your heads. Dear loving Lord, as we approach your throne of grace, Father, we come before you thanking you for another day where we can come and spend time studying and praying, talking to you. As we're about to go into our song service, I pray that you send the Holy Spirit to come and dwell amongst us in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, today is a very special day. It's kind of bittersweet, but today we want to take this opportunity to honor Sister Ayanti. To many of us, we know her as Auntie. So this morning, we want to use some of the songs. If you were early on Sabbath mornings to enjoy the first song service that we would have, you would hear a few of these songs this morning. So this morning, we want to start off with this hymn number 43. Amen. This next song says, morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing. Praise for the morning. Praise for the springtime, the spring fresh from the word. Hymn number 44.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blessed first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sun.
The writer says, there's the wonder of springtime and harvest, the sky, the stars, the sun, but the wonders of wonders that chose my soul is the wonder that only began. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Our song service for today has concluded. Until next week, we'll see you. God bless. To start, our theme song for today is I Will Go. Thank you.
Cause my eyes have seen the King. I must tell all the world, worship Him. In all the nations, in all the world, where He sends me, yes, I will go. I will go where You lead me. I will go where You lead me. Who will go for us? I will go. I will go where You lead me. I will go where You lead me. Here am I. Send me, Lord, I will go. I will go.
Hi, good morning. You're on, Sister Hines. Go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. Blessed Sabbath. I don't know what's going on with my phone this morning, but...
No, we hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. Happy Sabbath, each and everyone, this morning. I pray and ask that God will bless each and every one of us. I take this opportunity to welcome one and all to yet another Sabbath day of blessing. And as we sit at the feet of Jesus, I pray and ask that we all will receive that blessing is awaiting us this morning. So welcome one, welcome all. Do have a blessed sitting at the feet of Jesus. Glad to have you with us worshiping today. Blessed Sabbath day to everyone.
We are called to worship. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before Him with burnt offering, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise for the Son and only God. Amen.
Shall we bow our heads in prayer, please? Father, we thank you for the marvelous opportunity, the wonderful area, God, of a blessing that you have for us. Please, Father, accept our worship. Lead us into a powerful experience. And God, at the end, we are careful to give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise for Christ's sake. Amen.
Let me join with Sister Haynes and welcome us all to Community Service Day. At this time, we are going to invite Tisa Boyce from our Hillaby community who would lead us into the opening song. Tisha Boyce. Thank you. Let me thank Tisha, Boyce, for announcing the opening hymn from the Hillaby community. And Tisha is a visitor to us in our programs before the COVID situation came in. This morning to bring our scripture reading, which is from Luke 10, 37. It's Tyresha Griffith from the Rock Hall community. Tyresha is a student of the Dallas Jordan Secondary School. We want to invite her and welcome her and her family on board with us this morning from the Rock Hall community. If Tyresha, if you're hearing me, you can go ahead with the scripture lesson. Thank you. Tyresha, you might need to unmute. I'm not hearing you.
Morning.
Good morning.
But a certain Samaritan, as he joined, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, as he set him on his own animal. Hello?
Continue, I'm hearing you. Continue.
Brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to him, to the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will come again and will repay him. saw which of these three, so which of these three do you think was the neighbor to him who fell among the thieves?
And he said, who showed mercy on him? Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise.
Thank you so much, Tyresha. Thank you.
Welcome.
It is with hearts of gratitude and thankfulness that we approach thy divine throne on this your holy Sabbath day. Our hearts are made glad because you, in your love and mercy, have given your only begotten Son so that we can be rescued from this world of sin and eventually gain everlasting life in the earth menu. So this morning we rejoice in that great fact that you have sent your Son to die for us. We want to express our gratitude for your forgiving power. And so, Lord, we approach thy divine throne on bended knees, asking first and foremost that you will pardon and forgive us for our sins. In fact, you have said that if we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us for our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Lord, this morning as we come, we confess our sins, believing that you will keep your promise and that you will forgive us. And so now, since we have the assurance of forgiveness of sins, O Lord, we come to thee to make our requests. We do ask, Lord, that you will visit with us and that you will bless us. This morning, we want to pray for those who are sick. We want to remember those who mourn. We want to remember the Cummins family. We want to remember the Brathwaite family. We want to remember the Ford's family. We want to remember the Burroughs family, O God, for the loss of their loved ones. Comfort our hearts. And we look forward with great assurance to that great and marvelous day when you come to claim those of us who are faithful. Oh Lord, we pray this morning that you will keep us faithful and true so that we might meet with our loved one again. Hear our prayer, O Lord, on the behalf of those who mourn. We look also at the wider community of those who are sick, O Lord. You are the great physician. You have healed in the past. With all our hearts, we believe, oh God, that you can heal again. And so in the precious name of Jesus, the one who gave his blood on Calvary, we do pray, oh Lord, that you will heal us. We think of this community. Oh Lord, you know the needs. There are financial needs, there are social needs, there are spiritual needs, there are physical needs. But Lord, nothing is impossible with you. You make the impossible possible. And so we pray, Lord, that you will take care of our every need as we come on bended knees this day. Oh Lord, provide for us. We think of those who are in desperate circumstance. Oh Lord, hear our prayer on those behalf. This morning, we want to remember this church. We want to remember our young people. Oh Lord, bless them, we pray. Give them that desire to remain faithful and true to you. This morning, we await a special message from you. Oh Lord, visit with your special manservant. Grant him your peace, grant him your favor. And as you speak, oh God, grant that we might not hear him, but we might hear your blessed word. And those words might be transforming and uplifting to each and every one of us. Oh God, hear our prayer this day. Bless us, we pray. And eventually save us in your precious, worthy name. Amen and amen.
Hear our prayers, O Lord. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline thy ears to us and grant us
happy Sabbath, everyone. They can hear me.
Happy Sabbath. We hear you. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath to you. Happy Sabbath.
Yes. We will now have our special music done with Shanta Seely.
There is peace and contentment in the Father's house today. Lots of food on the table, and no one is turned away. There is singing and laughter as the hours pass by, but a hush comes singing as the Father sadly cried. My house is full, but my fields are empty. Go and work for me today. It seems my children all want to stay around my table, but no one wants to work in my fields. But no one wants to work in my fields. Push away from the table, look out through the window pane. Just beyond the house of plenty lies a field of golden grain, but is ripe on to harvest. But the reapers, where are they? In the house can't the children my fields are empty, who will go and work for me today? It seems my children all want to stay around my table, but no one wants to work in my fields. But no one wants to work in my fields. My house is full, but my fields are empty. Who will go and work for me today? It seems my children all want to stay around my table, but no one wants to work in my fields. But no one wants to work in my feet.
Thank you, Sister Shanta Reilly, for that beautiful number. Very appropriate. At this time, it's a time for offertory. And a share passes for him from Matthew 6, verse 19 to 21. Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. In this time in our lives, we have a world that is filled with greed. Here in Barbados and maybe elsewhere, everyone is crying out for rising prices. Consumers are screaming, the rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer. In the midst of this, Jesus is saying to us not to lay up treasures here on earth, because they will be corrupted and be put to waste. But he's asking us to cast our minds on heaven, and he instructs us to render to Caesar the things that are Caesar and to God the things that are God. These things are tithes and offerings and our life to him. And using these gifts that God's given us and return to him, we can reach the unreachable in all the corners of the earth. We can feed the hungry. We can clothe the naked. We can house the homeless and enlighten those in darkness. Let us lay aside, as God has asked us, our tithes and offerings as we return to him. Because of the situation, we cannot physically collect them from you. But I also want to remind you that if you have them available, you can consult, you can contact the pastor, anyone, the elders, and we can be able to deal with it for you. Let's remember then that God loves us and he expects us to love him in return, and he loves a cheerful giver. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the gifts you've given unto us. We thank you because we have health and strength, we can work and return to your own. Bless our gifts. And this morning, especially, I want to, at this time, remember Shaquille and his family in prayer. Whole household has requested prayer. They're all down with the COVID virus. And his grandmother, who is has some point, and he said in a bad way, his grandmother Jean, I want to lift her before this time, Father, as a church. We want to remember them in prayer at this time, that you be in the midst. You are still the great one that loves us and care for us, and you're a healer. You are the great physician. Into your hands we commit ourselves, our lives, our tithes, and our offerings, and all our gifts. Use them for your service, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we're going to have a children's feature.
Abraham, the father of Isaac, continued to remember the words spoken to him by God. Many years before, God said, "Leave your country and your people and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. All the people on the earth will be blessed through you." Abraham taught Isaac the importance of obeying the words of God so that Isaac and all his descendants would continue to receive the blessings from God. Many years later, Isaac married an Israelite woman named Rebekah. When Rebekah became pregnant, she and Isaac were very happy and excited. As the babies grew in her belly, they became very active and moved around continually. One day she asked the Lord, "Is moving around so much?" The Lord replied, "Two nations are in your womb. They will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other. The older will serve the younger." When it was time for the babies to be born, they named the firstborn baby Esau. He had red hair that covered his entire body. And the second baby to be born had a hold on Esau's heel, Jacob. As the boys grew up, Esau loved the outdoors and became a very good hunter. Jacob was a quiet man and worked among the tents. One day, Jacob was cooking a delicious stew when his brother Esau came in from a long day of hunting. He said to Jacob, "Bowl of stew if you will sell me your firstborn birthright." Esau replied, so Esau quickly sold his birthright to Jacob for a bowl of stew. Many years passed and Isaac grew very old. His eyes could no longer see and he knew his time to die was coming. He called his older son Esau to him and said, "Please, take your bow and arrow and go and catch some wild game for me. Prepare this meat for me that I may enjoy it and give you my blessing before I die." Isaac's wife, Rebekah, heard him tell Esau this, so she quickly called Jacob to her. She told Jacob to go and kill two young goats. When he returned, Rebekah told Jacob to go and put on his brother's clothes. She quickly prepared the goat meat and then covered Jacob's smooth skin with the goat skin in order to trick his father Isaac into thinking it was Esau. Jacob took the food to his father and said, "My father." "Yes, my son." "Your blessing." Then Isaac said to Jacob, "Please, come close to me so that I can touch you and see if you have the hairy skin of my oldest son Esau, and then I will know for sure." After Isaac touched Jacob, he said, "You have the voice of Jacob, but the hands of Esau. Are you really my firstborn son Esau?" "I am," Jacob replied. Isaac then ate the meat that Jacob had brought him, and then spoke the blessing over Jacob. "May all the people serve you, and the nations bow down to you. You will be Lord over your brothers, and may those who curse you be cursed, and those that bless you be blessed." This was the same blessing that God spoke over Jacob's grandfather, Abraham, many years before. When Esau returned and was told that Jacob had gone in and received the blessing before him, he was very angry and upset. He said to his father Isaac, "Jacob has taken my birthright, and now he's taken my blessing? Is there any blessing left for me?" He cried bitter tears of sadness over losing his blessing. All Isaac could do was tell Esau that from then on he would serve his younger brother Jacob until the end of his days.
Thank you so much. At this time, we have a special feature. We are privileged to have us this morning, Sister Harriet Cozier from the North New Milwaukee Water Church. And we have also the owner of the Frank Tony Heinz and Brother Robert Riley. I'm going to invite them to be on screen at this time. Sister Cozier. The hands is there. Sister Cozier. Sister Cozier, are you hearing us? Are you with us? Are you hearing? I know you were on earlier. All right, I'll proceed until she joins us. This morning we are focused on our community, our Goldman community. And there are two aspects of our community service that I want these gentlemen to dwell on. I'm going to begin first with Brother Robert. Robert, you have been involved in the community aspect of working with the homeless as your mission. Do you want to tell us what encouraged you to be involved in this aspect of working with the homeless community in Barbados? You're muted. Please unmute. I'm not hearing you.
Oh, sorry. Hi, Merry Sabbath all. Yeah.
Merry Sabbath.
First, I want to say that as Christians, I think it is in our nature to want to get involved in helping others. And when I heard from a friend of mine that she had started this charity about 10 years ago, you know, I got involved because a lot of us, you know, we want to get involved, but we just don't know like where we can help or who we can help. So established charity or organization, you know, makes it a little easier to get started.
Can you tell us any challenges that you face in this program?
Well, it started about 4 years ago. And I think one of the biggest challenges is, you know, not necessarily provision, having the food to provide, because we serve breakfast on Saturday mornings. on Sabbath mornings in Queen's Park, right? We have four teams. So each team does a morning in a month, yeah? But we have a great deal of hands to help. But I find that the biggest challenge would be not necessarily provision, but rehabilitation. Because 4 years ago, and I'm still seeing a lot of these same faces that I did that when I first started, you know, is a challenge. It means that, you know, they're probably still in the same position or maybe worse than they were 4 years ago. And then on top of that, you're seeing so many other faces. The charity started out with serving about 20 people, and now we are up to 85, 90 people. Especially with the pandemic, you know, it's a lot more people.
And are there any experiences that you want to share with us and you work among the homeless?
For one, don't do drugs. You know, I've seen instances when some of them will come, you know, and they're, you know, really high, fresh off the high, you know, they're violent, you know, not necessarily towards us, because what we find is that the others there are very protected of us. So anyone starts to talk towards us, it becomes a big issue, right? The ones that are serving food, anyone talks against us, it becomes a huge issue. So they usually pick them a fight among other homeless people, right? That is a huge problem, because to see firsthand the person that you saw the last time was there, you know, you say, hey, Robbie, how you doing, man? How things going? And, you know, you get to know them by name and personality and everything. And then to see this completely alter ego, you know, it is very disheartening. So the first thing I would say is don't do drugs, all right? Mm-hmm. That's on a negative note. On a more positive note, what I have seen that I found very interesting is I provide man brew, all right? The porridge. So the guys, they come back for seconds a lot, you know, but they will wait to just make sure that no one else is coming, you know, before they get, you know. And if it's a case where someone turns up when the last of it is sharing, they say, okay, no, you know, he should get it because he didn't get any, you know. And you get some that when we are winding down, they get a second share of food. And then all of a sudden someone turns up and they would give that food to another person. All right. So in a lot of cases, they're very sharing and caring and looking out for one another. So what Tisha was saying to one of the founders is that when she first asked them what they really wanted out of the program, you know, it had nothing to do with food or the particular menu, because our menu has become very extensive, right? You know, pancakes, cakes, you get fruit, you get porridge, you know, a whole lot of stuff, right? Sometimes they can't even hold all the stuff. But the most important thing to them was to be treated as people, as human beings. And, you know, working with them has really changed my perspective on how I view the homeless and people that are destitute. Is very eye-opening, and it's very, you know, you come to become a lot more sensitive towards their needs.
And you're enjoying it, and you see it as avenue for gospel.
Yeah, for sure. I like doing it, all right? It gives you a rewarding feeling, knowing that God can use you to help others. And then what I do too, as my capacity as personal ministries assistant, what I do is I would share literature with them, mainly priorities. But I've bought some, not great controversy. The Patriots and Patriots and Prophets, for a couple of them, has shown real interest. All right. So helping others is a form of ministry, and I'm just glad to be able to be used to minister to others in such a way.
Thank you, Brother Robbie. Amen. Amen.
Right.
Thanks be to God. Let's go to Brother Frank.
Amen.
Brother Frank, that's like the other side of community services. You have been in the Rock Hall area for a little while, pre-COVID and post-COVID. You want to share with us what's been happening that we have been doing in the Rock Hall area?
Yes, sir. Good morning to all. Pleasant Sabbath. I want to start this way is that some of us will remember or may remember that there was a company in Rock Hall. A little survey was carried out too. And within Rock Hall, there are about 4 Adventist people in Rock Hall out of hundreds of people. So we want to make Rock Hall a part of our family again. And what we are doing is that we are meeting, greeting, and most of all, making friends out of Rock Hall. We want them to be our family. 2, we are studying the Bible with them through the form of lesson study, of lesson. And we share food with them, food basket. The other part is that we have set up a tent in our hall so that they will have evangelistic meeting and other things that they can be involved in.
Mm-hmm. Could you also tell us about another project that we are looking at the Hillaby Church with, in conjunction with others, like the Deaconesses group?
Yeah, there's a home which needed to be painted. And we decided to paint the house for the person, not just now, a while ago, but the house needed, let me say, prepping, paint rubbing off and things like that. And so far, it's being done. So as soon as that is finished, we want to paint our friend home. And we need volunteers. Don't come and see it today and then tomorrow. We don't turn up. We need to be sincere and painting the home because it's overdue. And that is a great segment or aspect that people who know about the Bible, who know about we Adventist people, will see it happening and work.
Thank you so much for your invitation. I don't know if Sister Cozy will join us as yet.
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, Sister Cozy, welcome. You've heard my 2 colleagues. You are a veteran community service leader and worker from the North Mile Quarter. Because what encouraged you to get involved in this community service program?
Well,
yes.
I would say it seemed to be in my DNA. God prepared and have equipped me. I find in myself a deep love for humanity, very people-oriented, and readiness to give assistance to those in need, physical, financial, emotional, and spiritual. Also, I experienced poverty as a child growing up, having to take mangoes to school to sell in order to get lunch for my siblings and I, having to wear second and third hand clothing. People gave to my mother saying, "This is for the children." I live to see my mother as improvement came, sharing food stuff and clothing to many persons. So I do believe that all that laid the foundation for the warm and generous person that I am today. And let me add that I am most comfortable when doing outreach and helping to address the needs of others.
So praise God. But you would agree with me that community services have changed over time. Can you point some of the changes that we've had in the area? I know that people associate community service with food and clothing, but over time, how has it changed over time?
Well, there's a home health program going by government now. And so the lot of house cleaning that used to be involved our members, a lot of that don't take place anymore. And then there are those who were motivated by the programs of the National Federation of Community Services. And so they're kind of lost their motivation. They lost their motivation when these programs went down, because we had like the children's camps and the excursions and the outings and, you know, all that kind of stuff used to be happening. So that now, in the absence of these, having lost their enthusiasm, like cottage meetings and visits to seniors and children's homes and all that, these are now all on pause. So I would say we have to use the telephone a lot more and set aside some time to do our outreach from at home. But a lot of us still find time and ways of means of doing that outreach.
So as we conclude this morning, Rosie, you're talking using now creative ways to reach, so we can, because we can do a lot of face-to-face, face-to-face now, person-to-person. Right. So you have used some creative ways. And as we conclude this session this morning, you mentioned the challenges that we face.
Okay, but
what advice do you give? What advice do you give to fellow church members?
Before you get to that, I want to say that there are some programs that we have been involved in. We had like outreach to the police. That was a very well endorsed program by the Commissioner of Police. Then we had a program called the Good Neighbor Unit at the Morris Bayer Polyclinic, where we gave out our clothing and food stuff. We had health recipes and vegetarian recipes and, you know, lots of stuff, ground provision and all that. Then we have something called Plates of Love, which we do the last two Tuesdays in each month. And of course, because of COVID, this too is also on hold. That also had an educational aspect to it, where we would set up our boutique so that the children could come and make their selections and so on. Our veteran program though is one called Our Sunday Meals. This has been going on for more than 20 years. At first, we used to collect the lunches from a hotel, but since 2019, I had to start doing the lunches at home every Sunday. The challenges that we face going forward now is most of our committed and dedicated persons have either died or become inactive due to age and sickness. One big challenge would be finding persons to carry on. Another one would be money. So many of us sacrifice in time so that persons in need can get some help. And then when we hear the familiar song, you know, the church ain't got no money. So definitely access to money would be a challenge. Presently, COVID-19 is a challenge, but many of us are still finding ways to reach out. My advice though, if you don't have an attitude of service to others, if you are not enthusiastic nor motivated to become involved in this ministry of humility, but you want to be involved, then my advice to anyone at all is that you should start praying intentionally about it. Asking God to give you the mind of Christ, which will come with a love for service to others, compassion, and a generous heart. And Proverbs 21:13 says, if a man shuts his ears to the cry of the poor, he too will cry out and not be answered. So I encourage you, put aside your status, put aside your academic achievements, your job title, and become the eyes, ears, hands, and feet of Jesus in our community today. God bless you. Thank you for listening.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sister Rosie. I want to thank you for sharing with us. I want to thank Brother Heinz for coming on board and sharing with us in the whole community, and Brother Robert as the minister to the homeless. May God bless you all as we continue to work in this field and service for him. Service with a smile. Service with a smile. Unfortunately, during the week, we lost one of our veteran community service persons. I want this time, I want to pay a small tribute to her sister, Auntie Allen. Over to Brett at this time.
Auntie Ellen.
Let us remember the family in prayer and our Hillaby family in prayer. This journey for the family, that God be with them and comfort them even at this time.
Thank you, Brother Cecil. Good morning, church. Good morning, members. As we assemble here this morning for this special community services day presentation, that short tribute to Sister Auntie was fitting. My biggest regret is that I did not have enough photographs of her to make a tribute that really spoke to all the things that she did in terms of service to the Hillaby Church. As you know, she was a member of the Community Services Department for a long time, and she would have played an integral role in that department. Apart from her hospitality that is known far and wide. I heard Brother Chris mention it last night as we had our Sabbath school lesson study, that she was known for being there from beginning to end, preparing and making sure that everyone was well fed and happy. In fact, my couple weeks ago, I watched a presentation from Oakwood College Church when Dr. Beer was leaving to go to his new assignment. And I was surprised that there was a ministry called the Photography Ministry. And those people were able to present a really fitting tribute in photographs. And it jumpstarted me. Although Ayanti didn't like many photographs, I searched so many files to find those few photographs of her. A couple nights ago, I searched probably about 3,000 pictures to find those probably 8 photographs of her. And, you know, it just says to us that we don't know how long we're going to be here. There are people that we love that we really must let them know that we love them. We must do things to tell them that we really appreciate and cherish them. We never expected in 2021 that we would be in a season of sorrow where Sister Auntie would be gone. So let's appreciate one another and let's look to honor one another while we are still living, where they can really appreciate it. Today, we have a very special guest with us. Pastor Haynes is here to present to us today. We know that Pastor Haynes is a friend of Hillaby, and that is not debatable or disputable. He heads the Personal Ministries and Community Services Department of the conference, and I guess much more than that. And this time of COVID, and even in the past months when we had the volcanic eruption in St. Vincent, you realize that Pastor Haynes is a man of action. He's not mere talk, he's a man of plain action. And he made sure things are done. He is at the forefront of getting things done. He is energetic, effervescent. Although he's a going man, he's simply down to earth. And I think that we've been blessed in this church, in this conference, to have someone such as him in times like this, who will spare no effort to go to the ends of the earth to make sure what is supposed to be done is done. He is here with us once again. He has been with Hillaby on numerous occasions, because I can tell you, I can call him at the 11th hour and he will respond. Once he does not have anything that is really pressing, he will respond positively. And this morning, I'm certain when he comes, he's going to give us some words of encouragement. He's going to propel us to be like him, to be out there doing things, because there are lots of things to do. There's lots of community service out there that we can be involved in, so that our impact on the community, on the society, can be as such that people will know that we have been with Jesus. So Pastor Haynes will come to us, but before he comes, we will have Brother Peter Haynes, and he is another familiar face and voice with us. And Brother Peter Haynes will be giving us an item of special music. And yes, after that item of special music, the next voice you will hear will be that of Pastor Dale Haynes. Continue to have a very pleasant Sabbath, everyone.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, stealing love, God's proved faithful to me. Every word he has promised is true. What I told was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's been faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy could not pray. Still, my God, he was faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love, God was faithful. Open arms, and I know that once again, he's a bang, faithful to me. to believe. Yet he's been faithful, faithful to me. My God is faithful. He's been faithful. Amen. He's been faithful to all of us. And I'm so thankful. I'm so happy, so delighted to be here this morning. Elder Cummins, thank you so much for your invitation. Elder Argyle, thank you so much for your kind words of introduction. Truly a wonderful program this morning in terms of what I heard from all the participants, you know, pulling all the things together. Truly amazing, truly wonderful, and top class information. I want to thank Sister Sahins, A. Haynes, for your kind words of welcome, and those Sister Joy Walks to your kind words of welcome. Today, well, get into the word. As I was told, we go from 10 o'clock to 11:30, so bam, we're on time, all right? So 10 to 11:30, you got to wrap everything up. But hear this, everyone. Let's all bow our heads as we seek the word of God. Father, we thank you for your blessings, your goodness. Thank you, God, for your mercies, allowing us to be in the land of the living, and God, to on this platform to worship you, give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. Speak to our hearts now, dear God. Move in our lives for Christ's sake. Amen. I want to look at Luke chapter 10, as was ably read by the person this morning. Luke 10, we go down to verse 37. And look, Luke 10, 29 to 37. I will go, right? I will go into my community. And I hope this is the saying, this is the dream, this is the impetus, this is the reality of all of us. I will go into my community. I want to look at verse 29. It says, but he was willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, who is my neighbor? This was the lawyer, the Jewish lawyer, who ran to Jesus, you know, to justify himself. Can I tell you this, church there at Hillaby, that we don't justify ourselves. We let God justify us. We don't set the agenda for Jesus. We allow Jesus to set the agenda. So please, my friends, let's all humble ourselves so that indeed God would give us that blessing. But here he was, want to beat his chest and to maybe brag and say to the other, Jesus, see how good I am. But I'm glad that this work is not about us, Hillaby. This work is about God. And here it was, that he wanted to justify himself, said to Jesus, who is my neighbor? And here it was, verse 30. And Jesus answering him said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem down to Jericho. And here this, Hillaby. This story was hot off the press. This story of the Good Samaritan, it seemed, based on scholars, that it had just happened, and it was hot off the press, hot off the lips. In our world today, this story would have been on Facebook, on Twitter, on WhatsApp, but on all of them, cable everywhere. This story was a hot story. This story was hot, just like the story of Nicki Minaj's cousin friend. This is hot. So Jesus said, look, here's the deal. That this man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho. And as it says, he fell among thieves. As a matter of fact, the word should have been translated robbers. But the word translated for thief or thieves, that word simply meant they would just take your things, rob you, and allow you to go. But this one should have been a stronger translation, which was robbers. Because they beat him up and left him for half dead. So they were going from Jerusalem down to Jericho. And hear this, Hillaby. It seemed well that this place was a hotbed for robberies. Why? All the cracks and all the crevices and all the caves. Why? Because it was conducive, it seemed, to take things, hide them, and get away. Also, hear this, everyone, that according to Josephus,
Josephus was the church, the historian for the Jews. And Josephus said in his writings that they had about 40,000 people who were working to rebuild the temple. And they were all let off or let go or made redundant. And they were sent, so hence they had nowhere to work. So they became highway robbers. So get the deal. One day they were working on the temple, and the next day they were being fired, being laid off, now highway robbers. 40,000 of them. So it was easy to get robbed, going from Jerusalem down to Jericho. And as I said, well, the Philemon thieves should have meant Philemon robbers. And here it was. The priest passed by. And hear me, church. The priest passed by, didn't stop, because the priest felt, and according to his customs, and the custom of the church then, should he go by and a man and touch the man, and a man was dead, he would have to go back to the church and perform some rituals to be cleansed. But hear me, Hillaby. What was so wrong in going back to church? I thought church would have been a place of vibrancy. You want to go. You're excited to be in church. But this priest said, no. I am not touching him because I am not going back to church. And here's the deal. I pray that church is not a drab for us. I pray that church is not a place that we just boom want to leave. But I pray that in church, that there's a fullness of joy. In church, there's vibrancy. In church, there's love. I pray and hope that Hillaby Church will be a church you're excited to come to. And that priest passed by because of rites and rituals, and he didn't want to go back to church. My. Then the Levi passed. The Levi passed by, and my word, based on Sister White says in the Desires of Ages, that he convinced himself, Elder Cummings, he convinced himself that what he was doing was right. So he passed by too. And hear this. If you're not going to help, don't go peeping. Don't go just peeping to find a story. Because in my mind, I picture being in the place of the man who was robbed and beaten and left half dead. That some person coming close. The priest who walked by, well, bam, he was always going by. But picture this. Some person walking close. Anxiety builds. Hey, help is on his way. You can hear the sound of his feet and they're coming closer and closer and closer. And you feel excited. Help now is on his way. You can hear probably his breathing, and well, help is on its way. You can probably have his scent smelling. Help is on its way. And then, boom, he passed by. If you're not going to help, don't go peeping. Because you will just create anxiety and create in the minds of people, help is on its way, and bam, all dashed away. The Greek words for past, hear this, only use in those two instances. That's when the priest passed, special Greek word used. When the Levite passed, a special Greek word used to show well the indelible marks. Pass it in blood of the Levite and the priest. I will go. I will not go past. I will go. I will not go peeping, but I will go. And somebody say amen. I will go to help. And hear this, when Jesus would tell a story, hear this, it's not a time to get out your popcorn and all feel good. When Jesus told a story, it was a time always to check yourself. It was a time to shock. It was more powerful than Netflix, Marvel, DC, all put together. His story shocked the value system of the hearers. So hear this, the lawyer who asked Jesus to justify himself was expecting, if the priest passed, if the Levite passed, he wasn't expecting, well, the Samaritan to pass and stop. He was expecting, well, that some other layperson of the church will pass and stop. Because the Samaritans, and hear this, the Samaritans were said, to eat bread from a Samaritan is like eating swine. They said even the spit of a Samaritan woman was unclean. And some rabbis taught them that it is forbidden for a Gentile woman who is in distress, giving birth, that you should stop and help her. Because if you shall succeed, it is allowing another Gentile, another dog to come into the world. That word, you can understand that, Hillaby? Don't touch the Samaritan woman. Don't help her. Let her baby die. But Jesus shot that lawyer, that Jewish lawyer, and said, well, the Samaritan came by and the Samaritan helped. Hear this. Number one, I will go in my community. It must be intentional. The priest was restricted by rules and regulation. The Levite came peeping, but the Samaritan stopped. And Francis Chan says, we never grow closer to God when we just live life. It takes deliberate pursuit and attentiveness. Hillaby, we have to be intentional. Do you remember HMS Richards, those of us in the BC times, those before cable, HMS Richards, Voice of Prophecy? And he said, he read his Bible 160 times. At 10 years old, he was shot in his eye, but he determined about that he must read the Bible and read it. He read it 160 times. And he said, he knows the Bible so well that you just have to tell him a passage and he will tell you the verse before and repeat the verse before and the verse after. Intentional. We have to be intentional, Hillaby. Number two, we have to be involving. This thing involves our whole being. Such that, look, the Samaritan man involved, and he got down, helped him, took him to an inn, and he said to the innkeeper, he paid his money, and he said, but if you need anything else, I will come back and pay. Hear this, Hillaby. If he could not have paid the money back, his whole family would have been plunged and put into slavery. So when we do it with our whole heart. I've learned this by Mazdi Hale. She said, to make a difference in someone's life, you don't have to be brilliant, rich, beautiful, or perfect. You just have to care. My. Sister White says this in Desire of Ages, page 497. She says, in the story of the Good Samaritan, Christ illustrates the true religion. He shows that it consists, not here, this Hillaby, not in systems, in creeds, in rites, but in performance of loving deeds, in bringing the greatest good to others in genuine goodness. That's what it is. Being involved. Intentional, being involved. Get this one. Number three, it is going against the natural. The natural thing, if the priest passed, the Levite passed, in the mind's eye of the lawyer, oh, that Samaritan must pass. But that Samaritan went against what was natural. And one of us preparing this message, I saw this. That if the roles are argued, if the roles were reversed, and the Samaritan man was the one who was half dead, and that Jewish man was there coming down, he would have walked past him because his systems, his rights, his religion taught him to walk past. So if the roles were reversed, the Samaritan knew it. If the roles were reversed, that same man would have walked past him. But we're doing it not to receive favor. We're doing it not because I scratch your back, you scratch my back. I help you, you help me. I pull your string, you pull mine. No. This is about going beyond the natural into the supernatural. So even though you don't get accolades and applause and accomplishments, even though you don't get comeback, even though you don't get all the salutes and all, even though you don't get all of that, you're doing it for God. From the natural to the supernatural. And finally, I will go. because in my community, because God has transformed, and God has transformed me. Get this. Verse 36. Which of now of these three, thinking thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thief? Jesus saying to him, he said, he that shew mercy, Don, he that shew mercy on him. Then Jesus said to him, go, and do likewise. Go in your community. But this point must be made, that Jewish lawyer knew the answer, but his heart was not transformed. Elder Cummins, he cannot have brought himself to say the Samaritan. He can never even call the Samaritan the Samaritan. Still steeped in prejudice. Still steeped in putting down people. Still steeped on big eyes and small. You still steeped on classism. Still steeped in his ways. Couldn't call him Samaritan. All he said was the man who showed mercy. What I'm saying to all of us, in meeting Christ, we all must be transformed. This is not about image. This is not about mission statement. This is not about vision statement and value statement. This is not about simply, well, a strategic plan. This is about who we are. We are loving. Everywhere we go, people want to know who we are, where we come from. Well, we have been called by Christ. Well, we are Seventh-day Adventists. Why? God has placed in us love. We not only have the end-time message, but we also need the end-time massage. Not just high-tech, but being high-touch. So my friends today, let's all go. Let's all go. By being intentional. Let's all go by being involved. Let's all go by moving from the natural to the supernatural in terms of allowing God to lead us. And let us all go being transformed by the goodness of God. I will go. And I hope that you will go too. May God bless you all.
Amen. I want to thank Pastor Haynes for such a message in time like this. And I pray and ask that as we all heard from our dear pastor, we will take the message in heart to go out there as time like this, even though others need us more than ever right now for help in every area and aspect of life we could help. Let us go and do God's bidding. So thank you once again, Pastor, for that timely message in time like this. Let us pray. Our kind and Father, Lord, I thank you for once again this privilege where we could gather in your tabernacle, Lord, to hear a next message from you, Lord. I pray and ask, Lord, that your presence would continue to be among us, your people. I pray for your Holy Spirit, the downpouring of your Holy Spirit upon our lives, and bless us with a willing heart, Lord, that we would go and do service unto you and man, Lord, and bring glory and honor to your matchless name. Lord, help us individually to take time out to examine ourselves, find our interest in where we could go and help others, Lord, to spread the gospel, Lord. We pray and ask, Lord, as we continue to go through this week, go through the remaining of your Sabbath, bless us, keep us, come divine closely to us, and may your blessing fall afresh upon us. Continue to comfort our loved ones. Continue to be there and there with us, Father God. And in time like this, Lord, may we find ourselves more closer to you than ever before. So, Lord, continue to bless, guide, and protect each and every members, family, visitors. May they receive a blessing as well, Father God. Go with us as we go now, and may your grace continue to show us the way where you would have us to go and do your work. Thank you, Lord, for answering hearing prayer. Once again, I give you praise. I give you thanks. Forgive us of our sins, and may our prayers be answered unto thee. In Jesus' name, pray. Amen.
Well, we are you.
as we close this morning, we're going to sing the Psalm 340. And I want to encourage us to be back this afternoon. This afternoon, we're back this afternoon at 4:15 for our AY program. And we have our director with us again this afternoon. And we're privileged to have to welcome the Meverton Church with us this afternoon, a joint AY program at 4:15. So as we go, we're going to turn number 340 as we close.
We have heard a joyful sound. Jesus is, Jesus is. Spread the gladness all around. Jesus is, Jesus is. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward tis our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing ye islands of the sea, echo back ye ocean caves. Us shall keep our jubilee. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing above the battle strife, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. By his death and endless life, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing it softly through the gloom, when the heart for mercy craves. Sing in triumph for the tomb, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Give the winds a mighty voice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free, highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory.
Happy Sabbath, everybody, and we enjoy the rest of your Sabbath. I look forward to seeing you this afternoon online at 4:15. Thank you so much.
Happy Sabbath. Lovely program. Happy Sabbath.